Hello everyone, in this video I am going to explain the chapter taken from Vistas book grade 12, Journey to the End of the Earth, written by Dishani Doshi. Now this chapter talks about the journey. It's a travelogue. So this talks about the journey which was taken by the narrator or the author to Antarctica. So this chapter basically revolves around the world's most preserved place, which is Antarctica. Not many people have been there, but out of the few that have, Dishani Doshi is one of them. Basically a South Indian person, she went on an expedition with a group of teenagers affiliated with Students on Ice program, who takes young minds to different ends of the world. So this chapter will give an insight into how Antarctica is the place you should visit to have a glimpse of past, present and the future in its realist form. So here you can see a little bit introduction about Dishani Doshi. She was born on 9 December 1975, an Indian poet, journalist and a dancer based in Chennai. So she was born in Madras. Earlier Chennai was known as Madras, India, to a Welsh mother. Welsh means the people who belong to Wales, which is the city in Britain, United Kingdom. So those people are called Welsh. So her mother is a British and Gujarati father. She graduated with a master's degree in creative writing from the Johns Hopkins University. So in this lesson, the writer describes the journey to the coldest, driest and windiest continent in the world, that is Antarctica. The world's geological history is trapped in Antarctica. And the lesson refers to the manner in which geological phenomena enables us to trace the history of mankind. It also tells us about the way in which landmasses and countries are formed. The writer emphasizes on the impact of human endeavor to dominate nature. So here our lesson starts. Early this year, I found myself aboard a Russian research vessel, the Akademik Shokolsky, heading towards the coldest, driest, windiest continent in the world, Antarctica. My journey began 13.09 degrees north of the equator in Madras and involved crossing 9 time zones, 6 checkpoints, 3 bodies of water, and at least as many ecospheres. So in this paragraph, these few lines, we came to know that the author is talking about her journey to one of the coldest, driest and windiest continent on Earth, Antarctica. And she went there on a Russian research vessel known as Akademik Shokolsky. Here you can see the ship. This was called Akademik Shokolsky. So the author, who is basically a South Indian girl, she began her journey from Madras. And on her voyage, she crossed 9 time zones, 6 checkpoints, 3 water bodies, and just as many ecospheres. By the time I actually set foot on the Antarctic continent, I had been traveling over 100 hours in combination of a car, an aeroplane, and a ship. So my first emotion on facing Antarctica's expansive white landscape and uninterrupted blue horizon was relief, followed up with an immediate and profound wonder. Wonder at its immensity, its isolation, but mainly at how there could ever have been a time when India and Antarctica were part of the same landmass. Now, in this paragraph, she is talking about the 100 hours in which she completed her traveling using car, aeroplane, and then a ship to reach the continent. And when she first set her feet on the continent, she felt utmost relief for it, because it was all white as far as her eyes could see. The sight of the blue horizon was also very comforting, and next emotion that followed was that of wonderment. So she was feeling wonder. She was astonished by the fact that there was once a time when India and Antarctica were geographically connected. So the country in which we are living now, India, was a very much part of Antarctica. So Antarctica and India, they both were the same part of the same landmass. So now the chapter is divided into basically main three parts. So the first part where she talks about the history of Gondwana. 650 million years ago, a giant amalgamated southern supercontinent, Gondwana, did indeed exist, centered roughly around the present-day Antarctica. Things were quite different then. Humans hadn't arrived on the global scene, and the climate was much warmer, hosting a huge variety of flora and fauna. For 500 million years, Gondwana thrived, but around the time when the dinosaurs were wiped out and the age of mammals got underway, the landmass was forced to separate into countries, shaping the globe much as we know it today. So, in this paragraph, the writer is talking about that millions of years ago, there was a supercontinent known as Gondwana. Supercontinent means a continent which was very large and from which other continents have been broken off and drifted away. So, as we have read, that India and Antarctica were both of the same landmass. So, here, Gondwana, it was known as Gondwana. So, Gondwana was the main supercontinent. So here she is talking about that time things were quite different because there were no humans and climate was much warmer, which gave rise to huge varieties of flora and fauna. Gondwana flourished for 500 million years until dinosaurs got extinct and human beings came into existence. The huge continent was then forced into segregation to form countries and the world which we know of it today. To visit Antarctica now is to be a part of that history, to get a grasp of where we have come from and where we could possibly be heading. It's to understand the significance of Cordilleran folds and Precambrian granite shields, ozone and carbon, evolution and extinction. When you think about all that can happen in a million years, it can get pretty mind-boggling. Imagine India pushing northwards, jamming against Asia to buckle its crust and form the Himalayas, South America drifting off to join North America, opening up the Drake Passage to create a cold circumpolar current, keeping Antarctica frigid, desolate, and at the bottom of the world. So here, let's understand first the new terms used in this paragraph. Cordilleran folds means an extensive chain of mountains or mountain ranges. Precambrian granite shields means large areas of relatively low elevation that forms part of continental masses. Mind-boggling means overwhelming, startling. Frigid means very cold in temperature, and desolate means lonely, which is uninhabited by human beings or any living being. So here in this paragraph, the writer is trying to tell us that if we want to have a glimpse of history, if we want to learn from where we have originated, from where we have come and where we are heading to. So if we want to understand all these things, then Antarctica is the right place, because this is the best place to research and understand about mountain ranges, low elevation continents, ozone and carbon, evolution and extinction. So if you have all these questions, if you have any question related to all these things, topics, then Antarctica is the best place to go and find out the answers. Because Antarctica is the only place which is capable of giving an insight of the future, and that can be really startling. For a sun-worshipping South Indian like myself, 2 weeks in a place where 90% of the Earth's total ice volumes are stored in a chilling prospect, not just for circulatory and metabolic functions, but also for the imagination. It's like walking into a giant ping-pong ball devoid of any human markers. No trees, billboards, buildings. You lose all earthly sense of perspective and time here. The visual scale ranges from the microscopic to the mighty. Midges and mites to blue whales and icebergs as big as countries. The largest recorded was the size of Belgium. So days go on and on and on in surreal 24-hour austral summer light, and a ubiquitous silence interrupted only by the occasional avalanche or calving ice sheet consecrates the place. It's an immersion that will force you to place yourself in the context of the Earth's geological history. And for humans, the prognosis isn't good. So here in this paragraph, she is trying to tell us that it was a very different experience for her. Why? Because to come from a place like South India and sun worshipping, so being a sun worshipping South Indian, it was a very different kind of experience for her to be a place to be in a place where 90% of the Earth's total ice volumes were stored. Okay, so not only biologically and physically difficult, but also for imagination. So that was very difficult to even imagine. A place which is untouched by humans and their inventions, it gave an experience that made her forget about all the other things. From small creatures like midges and mites to huge creatures like blue whales and icebergs, icebergs as big as countries. So everything can be found in Antarctica. Days are never ending with sunlight all the time falling on the southern hemisphere. So it is such a quiet place which is not at all disturbed by anything apart from the falling mass of snow rapidly down a mountain, avalanche. So only this is the only thing which can create any noise. Rest all places are very quiet, is very quiet. So it is a setting that forces you to ponder upon Earth's geological history and helps you to foresee future, which for humans doesn't seem very pleasant. So the future which you see here, that is quite, you can say that is not at all pleasant for human beings, which the future which you foresee after visiting Antarctica. Now in this part, she is talking about the impact of human civilizations. Human civilizations have been around for a paltry 12,000 years, barely a few seconds on the geological clock. In that short amount of time, we have managed to create quite a ruckus, etching our dominance over nature with our villages, towns, cities, megacities. The rapid increase of human populations has left us battling with other species for limited resources, and the unmitigated burning of fossil fuels has now created a blanket of carbon dioxide around the world, which is slowly but surely increasing the average global temperature. So here she is trying to tell us that human beings, though human civilization came 12,000 years before, 12,000 might sound a very big span of time, but actually if we compare it, we keep it in the geological clock, it is barely few seconds. So in that short amount of time only, human beings have managed to create a lot of chaos in the nature by engraving the human, you can say, dominance over every natural thing by making villages, towns, cities, mega cities. So we have etched our dominance everywhere, and the rapid increase of human population also has given a threat, it's a threat to unlimited exploitations of fossil fuels, which has again created a blanket of carbon dioxide around the earth. So gradually we are, increasing the problem of global warming. Climate change is one of the most hotly contested environmental debates of our time. Will the West Antarctic ice sheet melt entirely? Will the Gulf Stream ocean current be disrupted? Will it be the end of the world as we know it? Maybe, maybe not. Either way, Antarctica is a crucial element in this debate, not just because it's the only place in the world which has never sustained a human population and therefore remains relatively pristine in this respect, but more importantly because it holds in its ice cores 500,000-year-old carbon records trapped in its layers of ice. If we want to study and examine the Earth's past, present, and future, Antarctica is the place to go. Now, here in this paragraph, the writer is talking about all the questions which are prevailing, which are the topics of debates pointing towards all the questions like melting of Antarctic sheet, disruption of Gulf Stream, ocean, and how the world will end. So these are the questions which still remain unanswered. Regardless, Antarctica remains an important part, not only because it is untouched by humans, but also because of the ice core's 500,000-year-old carbon records trapped in its layers of ice. So the carbon records which are trapped in the layers of the ice, they are very important to study. So if you wish to study or analyze Earth's past, present, and future, then Antarctica is the best place to go. Students on Ice, the program I was working with on Shokalski, aims to do exactly this by taking high school students to the ends of the world and providing them with inspiring educational opportunities, which will help them foster a new understanding and respect for our planet. It's been in operation for 6 years now, headed by Canadian Geoff Green, who got tired of carting celebrities and retired rich curiosity seekers who could only give back in a limited way. With Students on Ice, he offers the future generation of policymakers a life-changing experience at an age where they are ready to absorb, learn, and most importantly, act. So here in this paragraph, we came to know that the writer was on this she reached to Antarctica on this program, Students on Ice program, which was headed by Canadian Geoff Green. So Canadian Geoff Green took high school students on an expedition to the end of the Earth to make them realize about the impact that human intervention could have on nature. He wanted the policymakers, the future policymakers, which is the young generation, because they are going to make the future. So he wanted them to understand, to experience how difficult it would be to sustain life with the rising temperatures. And he wanted them to see the melting ice shelves so that they could estimate the trouble that mankind was heading to. And he was, in this paragraph, these lines, another reason why he wants to take the young generation only on this program, because he's tired of carting celebrities and retired. So he doesn't want to take rich people anymore, rich people and retired people anymore, because they just go for a pleasure trip. They don't want to understand the purpose behind that trip. So he wants someone to who can understand about the problem which is approaching to human beings. The reason the program has been so successful is because it's impossible to go anywhere near the South Pole and not be affected by it. It's easy to be blasé about polar ice caps melting while sitting in the comfort zone of our respective latitude and longitude, but when you can visibly see glaciers retreating and ice shelves collapsing, you begin to realize that the threat of global warming is very real. So here, basically, the author is telling that the program, the Students on Ice program, has been very successful, because whosoever has gone here to Antarctica has been affected by the place. When we are sitting at our home, it's possible that we may be indifferent. Blasé means indifferent, indifferent to the fact that polar ice is melting down. But when you actually see the glaciers melting and collapsing, you understand that the threat of global warming is very real. So you cannot stay unaffected by this fact if you visit Antarctica. Antarctica, because of our simple ecosystem and lack of biodiversity, is the perfect place to study how little changes in the environment can have big repercussions. Take the microscopic phytoplankton, those grasses of the sea that nourish and sustain the entire Southern Ocean's food chain. These single celled plants use the sun's energy to assimilate carbon and synthesize organic compounds in that wondrous and most important of processes called photosynthesis. Photosynthesis. Scientists warn a further depletion in the ozone layer will affect the activities of phytoplankton, which in turn will affect the lives of all the marine animals and birds in the region and the global carbon cycle. So in the parable of the phytoplankton, there is a great metaphor for existence. Take care of the small things and big things will fall into place. So basically in this particular paragraph, first I'll try to tell two, three meanings. Assimilate means take in and understand fully. So any information or ideas, so you understand that. And what else we found? Depletion. Depletion, reduction in number or quantity of something. And here in the last line, you can see parable. Parable means a simple story. You can say moral story or spiritual lesson. So parable means a moral story. So here in this paragraph, the writer is trying to tell us that the quality, because of that Antarctica is different, that the quality that makes Antarctica different is its simple atmosphere and lack of biodiversity. Because lack of biodiversity, because of which the changes are easily observed and which brings great consequences. Repercussions means consequences. So for example, the microscopic phytoplankton, those grasses of the sea that nourish and sustain the entire Southern Ocean's food chain, these single-celled plants use the sun's energy to assimilate carbon and synthesize organic compounds in that wondrous and most important of processes called photosynthesis. Scientists warn that a further depletion in the ozone layer will affect the activities of phytoplankton, which in turn will affect the lives of all the marine animals and birds of the region. So the here actually the final message what the writer is trying to give is that if we take care of the small things, big things will automatically be taken care of. Now, this is the third part of the chapter, Walk on the Ocean. My Antarctic experience was full of such epiphanies. Epiphanies means the manifestation of a supernatural or divine reality. So, my Antarctic experience was full of such epiphanies, but the best occurred just short of the Antarctic Circle at 65.55 degrees south. The Shokalski had managed to wedge herself into a thick white stretch of ice between the peninsula and Tadpole Island, which was preventing us from going any further. The captain decided we were going to turn around and head back north, but before we did, we were all instructed to climb down the gangplank and walk on the ocean. So there we were, all 52 of us, kitted out in Gore-Tex and glares, walking on a stark whiteness that seemed to spread out forever. Underneath our feet was a meter thick ice pack, and underneath that 180 meters of living, breathing salt water. In the periphery, crab-eater seals were stretching and sunning themselves on ice floes, much like stray dogs will do under the shade of a banyan tree. It was nothing short of a revelation. Everything does indeed connect. So let's first understand the difficult words and phrases in this particular paragraph. Epiphanies, as I told earlier, it means the manifestation of a supernatural or divine reality. Then wedge. Wedge means force into a narrow space. And then gangplank means a short bridge or platform that can be placed between the side of the ship and the shore, or a boat, from where the people can go on and off the ship. Then Gore-Tex, it's a synthetic waterproof fabric which is used to make outdoor or sports clothing. And glares means glasses. And then crab eater is an animal, is a particular kind of seal. So here you can see the picture of crab eater in your textbooks also. And floes means a sheet of floating ice, and revelation means to having a which is something not disclosed, which is not hidden. And that's it. So I'll just try to summarize this particular paragraph. So here the narrator, she is talking about the experience which she had during her journey, and out of that, the most divineful experience was to have a walk on the beach. So she is describing one of the experience which she had here. Their vessel had managed to cut across thick ice between the peninsula and Tadpole Island, and they were unable to go ahead due to the thick ice. They were about to take turn, but then they decided to come out and have a walk on the ocean. All of the 52 students were provided with a kit, suit, and glasses, sunglasses. So underneath their feet was a meter thick ice pack, and underneath that was, you can say, living, breathing salt water, 180 meters of 180 meters down. So in the periphery, crab eaters were also sitting, stretching themselves and sunning themselves on ice floes, just like the stray dogs you can witness in the villages or the cities sitting under the shade of banyan tree. So here she is having a kind of comparison between the two worlds. It was nothing short of a revelation. Everything does indeed connect, means it was nothing short of something which was not disclosed. Everything was clear in front of her, and she could make a connection between the two worlds. Nine time zones, six checkpoints, three bodies of water, and many ecospheres later, I was still wondering about the beauty of balance in play on our planet. How would it be if Antarctica were to become the warm place that it once used to be? Will we be around to see it? Or would we have gone the way of dinosaurs, mammoths, and woolly rhinos? Who's to say? But after spending 2 weeks with a bunch of teenagers who still have the idealism to save the world, all I can say is that a lot can happen in a million years, but what a difference a day makes. So here in this paragraph, she is showing her concern after traveling nine time zones, six checkpoints, and three bodies of water, and many ecospheres. She is wondering whether the humankind will be able to save the world, or she is thinking about the implications of the melting of ice in Antarctica. So she is thinking, will the older time of dinosaur and mammoths come back? Mammoths means it's a large extinct elephant of you can say of a special kind of breed, having typically you will find full of hair and with sloping back and long curved tusk. So she is thinking that maybe the older time of dinosaur and mammoth come back. And she says that after spending 2 weeks with a bunch of teenagers who still have the idealism to save the world, she can just hope that a lot can happen in a million years, but what a difference a day makes. So on this note, she ends the chapter, ends the travelogue. And these are a few slides which will give you an idea how Antarctica looks. That's it. So this is the end of the explanation. Thank you.